is Gregory Shelton from Historic Living Modern World. Today we're in Coatesville, PA at the Grand National. It's the 7th annual. It's hot, loud cars, loud motorcycles. I cannot wait to experience it.
This event gives spectators the chance to experience the sights and sounds of historically vintage cars and motorcycles while they track a 2-mile course through the city of Coatesville. This is the only event of its kind on the East Coast.
It's one thing to sit on the sidelines, but today I'm going to be riding in the car with Dane Holland and his vintage Jaguar.
Checkers out.
Jaguar is a 1963 XKE fixed head coupe. Dane and his Jaguar won best in show in the 2022 event, and when I saw it, I knew I had to ride in it. This car is absolutely stunning, and let me tell you, it's not just pretty, it's fast. In the early 1990s, Dane spent some time working in the racing industry. He set his sights on finding an E-Type. His search paid off. Within days, he had a line on a fixed head coupe coming out of storage. He bought it and had it shipped from California and was immediately surprised. The car was already raced for 2 years in the Northeast, and then it sat in a warehouse for 26 years. Now it's one of Dane's prized possessions, and I can see why. What an amazing ride. He's a great driver, and although it's scary at times, he handled it like the pro that he is. We all love vintage cars, but to me, there's nothing like the sound of a vintage bike. And when you think about vintage racing, the Isle of Man TT is it. Enter Dave Roper.
What does it feel like to be at Coatesville today? I know you weren't here last year. What does it feel like this year?
Well, it's certainly a record turnout. A lot more vehicles, both bikes and cars here.
So you already rode your first heat. How'd it feel?
Felt good. Yeah, part of the reason we're here is to shake this bike down for the last race of the season at Barber Motorsports in 2 weeks.
Dave, you're the first American to win the Isle of Man, dude. What does that feel like?
Well, it was it's certainly a high point in my career. It's been all downhill since then. No, it's quite a heady feeling. And, it's more difficult for a foreigner to, the logistics of it are very involved in getting a bike over there and learning the course and so forth.
Sure.
So it is a bit of an accomplishment. I have to give credit to Team Obsolete and giving me a fast bike.
So when you, what was your top speed, if you can remember what that was?
Top speed was probably around 130 miles an hour.
Okay.
My fastest lap at that time when I run the race was, I believe, 96 miles an hour.
You knew the volatility of that race. Did that get in your head at all, or were you just ready to win that damn thing?
Oh, no. It was very mixed conditions. When we started the race, it was dry, but you could see the weather coming in. On the first lap, up on the mountain, you'd see the clouds rolling in.
And
on the second lap, it started to rain. But depending when you started, you'd hit the rain at different places. Some places, the road was wet, but the sun was out.
Gotcha.
Some places,
slowed you down a little bit.
The road was dry, but it was raining.
You know? Right. Well, I have to tell you, I've heard a rumor that you didn't even know you won. Is that true?
You can't be sure. But on the last lap, people were waving their programs at me. And when I came out of the gooseneck up on the mountain, someone held up a number one sign.
Oh, my gosh.
So I thought I must be doing pretty good, but we hadn't even been warned about the opposition putting out disinformation.
Thinking you won. Interesting.
So,
it's a tactic.
So you don't know, and someone could have started well behind you, but made up time
for
on you.
Sure. So. Well, the other thing I think is so impressive about your career is the Motorcycle Man documentary. Can you tell me how that came about and why it's so important to your career?
Daniel Lovering, who did the video, he got in touch with me and said he wanted to do this. And I said, you know, it's been done. Another friend had done a video about me. And he said, yeah, I know, but I got a different take on it. I said, sure, if you want to do it, fine. And I had actually, in 1980, I had bought a motorcycle from his dad.
Okay.
I bought a Velocet.
Oh, wow.
And so he was aware of me for decades.
Sure. You know,
and he thought it'd be a good subject, and
gotcha.
I think he did an excellent job.
Tell me a little bit about the bike that you ran in that.
I ran a 1959 Matchless 250.
Wow.
And it's the only Matchless 250 ever to win a TT.
Wow.
And it was well developed. It had been developed by an American racer, Al Gunter. And so I had a modified cylinder head.
Okay.
And at the time, it could have been the fastest bike in the race, which never hurts.
No, for sure. Absolutely. So you got a Matchless today. Tell me a little bit about this baby.
Well, this one has a frame made by Dick Band.
Okay. Oh, gosh. Of course.
So it's the G50 motor, but in a special chassis.
Sure.
And it's got Sirianni forks.
Okay.
And it's got a Fontana 210 millimeter front brake, a Matchless G50 rear wheel. It's got a six-speed Team Obsolete Quaife gearbox.
Congratulations, man. You have such a storied career, and you make everyone who's a motorcycle enthusiast wish they were you. So thanks, brother. Hope you have a wonderful, safe day. Thanks, brother.
Thank you.
I got a chance to spend some time with Heather Carroll Wiggin and her beautiful 1971 BMW R75 sidecar.
So Heather, how did the race feel today? Because I have to be honest, you're riding in a sidecar in a toaster. How the hell does that work?
So it's a lot of fun, but the race today is great because we have a chance to really maneuver, and the elevation changes are pretty cool, and we get to bring sidecar racing to the people of Coatesville.
How many races do you do a year?
It depends on where we want to go and what tracks we want to do. Loudon, New Hampshire is our home track. That's what we normally do. We race the USCRAs. And then sometimes we do ARMA, like we can go to Barber and things like that as well.
So I love this bike. It's such a beautiful bike. Are you a BMW gal?
I am when it comes to three wheels. I've usually done British stuff. We did a BSA before this. But in order to come up to the Super Vintage class and be faster and more competitive, we went with the BMW.
How did you learn how to ride and drive with a sidecar?
We watched others do it. When I first saw it, I knew right then and there that I wanted to do this. I normally drive with my dad. And so I was like, I want to hang out with him. I want to spend time. Let's do this. And my dad's like, all right, find a rig. We'll do it. And our first rig came out from California. We learned on that one. It was a heavier, slower rig. But we learned at Loudon that has so many technical tracks. So once you learn to ride there, you can ride anywhere.
So when we talk about the people that would be our viewers, you know, a lot of times you look at this as like a World War II vehicle. What's the link between speed and like a military bike compared to a speed bike?
Sure. Well, the military bikes are set up for purpose, just like the race bikes are.
Transportation for more people,
correct,
right?
Correct. And the sidecars, I think, just naturally evolved into something because we want to race everything we possibly can.
Sure.
Whether it, you know, no matter what it is. And so it definitely is a different handling on the racetrack doing a race bike like this, but it's so much fun.
I'm assuming that danger is part of your DNA.
Yes. I mean, there's nothing, anytime you step on the track, no matter what you're in, there's an element of that. But when you trust your driver and you trust the process and you work hard, it becomes almost seamless, and that's not even part of it anymore.
Very cool. And we look at Coatesville as an event. What did you grasp from today as far as the people and the place and the course and most of those things?
I think it's a very, very well-run event. It's seamless from the moment you get here to the moment you're on the track. I think a lot of people are so excited to see this and have this happen here. We've had so many people ask us, oh my God, I've never seen this live, so this is incredible. We see it on TV, but now we get to see you do it, and it's so fun, and I get so many questions. I love when younger girls want to talk to me about how I got into the sport or why I did it, and they tell me about their dirt bikes, they tell me about their road racers and things like that, and it's awesome.
Congratulations goes out to Sam and Heather Wiggin for winning Best in Show for their vintage motorcycle, and William Richter wins Best Vintage Car in his 1970 AMC AMX.